Nous allons aborder maintenant la thématique
Now let's talk
planétaire.
About the limits of the planet. What do we mean by that? These are the limits that we should not exceed in order to avoid a change in the state of the Earth system, which would not be beneficial for us, obviously. So these planet limits are the 9 indicators that allow us understanding since when and how in the future we will move to Anthropocene. Anthropocene is the geological era that started with the great speeding up in the 50s in the 20th century, the great speeding up in the booming in our economic activities, in human demography. All these booms had a dramatic impact on the Earth system, and it's this dramatic impact that we measure with these planet limits. The 2 papers that were published were that of Jean Rockström called Planetary Boundaries, and this article was published in 2009, and it was reviewed and amended by Will Stiffen, who was already an author of the first paper, and this paper was published in January 2015, and when in 2009 we had exceeded 3 boundaries, well, since 2015 we've exceeded an additional one. So these boundaries make us leave the Holocene era, that lasted 11,700 years, and it was characterized by a relative stability of conditions on Earth and led to the development of agriculture and great civilizations. The 2 first boundaries we exceeded, just one of these boundaries led us shift and move to a new state of the Earth system. We do that because we have a massive impact on the system, but the system itself is going to react. And we will talk about some of these reactions and make a list of these various limits. So the 2 first limits, which have an impact on climate change, on biodiversity, these are boundaries that we've already exceeded, and just these limits make us shift to a state which is totally different from the environment that we experienced in the past. So let's take climate to start with. I will sometimes add things that you won't find in Rockström's papers, but the idea is to provide you with the basic knowledge in this field. So the first boundary about climate change that derives from the chemical composition of the atmosphere due to the greenhouse gases that we emit. So once again, fundamental knowledge dates back to the 19th century with Tyndall. In 1966, we stabilized our knowledge with regards to greenhouse gases, and we can demonstrate how CO2 entraps infrared light that we emit. So this knowledge is quite old. It's been published, and we've modelized all this since the beginning of the 70s. We had 2 models to begin with, now we have 50 models to help us better understand and try and look at the major trends which are underway. So the major effects of climate change are an average increase in temperature. Average increase in temperature we've already experienced
pratiquement une hausse
an increase of 1 degree already since the 1970s, we can fear a 4 to 6 degrees increase, and we can hope that the effect of COP21 will help us slow down this increase and limit this increase to less than 2 Celsius. But in the previous geological era, when we moved from the interglaciation to inner glaciation, temperatures were an increase of 1 Celsius for 1,000 years, and there we'll have 3 to 4 Celsius in 1 century. That changes everything. So think about the temperature of your body. It's quite similar. So an overall increase in temperatures, increase in sea levels, then modification of the rainfall regime, and fourth consequence, extreme events, with the most extreme events being more numerous. If we look at the indicators provided by big global indicators providers, there would be 3 to 4 times more extreme events than 30, 40 years ago at the moment. So these are the direct effects of climate change. But what we need to understand is that climate change swings the entire system. And we are talking about a very long period of time. In almost 1,800 years, there will be an excess of greenhouse gases that we will have injected in the atmosphere. And if we get a 5 Celsius increase in temperature for the next century, this will last for probably 5,000 years, and it will slow down then afterwards. And it takes 100,000 years for an excess of carbon dioxide to be absorbed by the atmosphere, and it's never totally absorbed. So we're talking about very significant changes and irreversible changes. And what we need and understand, even though we have stable, robust knowledge, but climate is such a complex system that surprises and bad surprises may happen. At the beginning of 2016, we understood that we probably had to revisit the role of clouds, because in clouds you have water droplets and ice crystals that send solar energy back into space. But the droplet effect is probably more important than that of ice crystals. And if that was the case, we would have to revisit the sensitivity of climate to all the emissions we send in the atmosphere. So that's for the first limit. This one has been exceeded. And not to exceed it, we should not have exceeded 350 parts per million of carbon equivalent, so 350 molecules of carbon for 1 million molecules of air. And we are above 400 ppm at the moment. So that's for the first boundary that we have exceeded, that about climate change. The second boundary that we have exceeded is about biodiversity. So let's talk about 3 different things with regards to biodiversity. We have erosion of population. Then we'll talk about the species erosion rhythm. And we talk about genetic diversity, and then we'll look at the effect in terms of functional biodiversity, even though they're more difficult to understand. So let's start with population erosion. Let's look at this very quickly. This is a map showing the fish resources at the beginning of the 20th century, and this is the situation at the beginning of the 21st century. So we've not yet emptied the ocean, but we're getting close to that. And that's a perfect symptom of what we're doing. When we're talking about life and biodiversity, we are setting aside the bacterial foundation of life and we look at pluricellular species. So now, coming back to just the erosion of wild populations, and between 1970 and 2010, half the mammals, half the birds, half the fish, as shown on this slide, half amphibians, half reptiles that disappeared. And as you know, the situation is not really getting any better for insects. So we are having an impact on something which is essential for life. Part of these wild species that existed were replaced by domestic species, so there is a very significant erosion. Now, talking about the erosion of biodiversity per se, so that's how species disappear, hence how genetic diversity disappears. I'm going to take a criterion which is not used in Dropstrom and Stephen papers, but let me take another indicator, which is the one of the number of species that disappeared over a century. But before I give you this figure, I'd like to remind you about something very important. When we talk about biodiversity erosion, we're not looking at the bacterial threshold, which is at the basis of life. We are talking about the erosion in complex living beings. So, over the history of the Earth, species were disappearing at the following momentum: 2 species out of 10,000 and over 2 centuries. Depending on the categories, we are currently having 100 species per 10,000 species over a century, and for some specific types, we're at 800 out of 10,000 over 2 centuries. So that's an incredible increase in the speed at which species disappear, and this would be the 6th extinction which is underway, and climate change is obviously going to contribute to that. So there again, we're talking about a shift. As you know, this is the 2nd field for which we reached a threshold: erosion of biodiversity, reduction in underlying genetic diversity, and to all this we have to add the impact on functional biodiversity, i.e. on the services provided by ecosystems, and without which other species could not live on the Earth. There are 3 major categories. The first one are everything that we get from nature, fibers, molecules that we use, cereal, etc., etc. That's the number one category of services. Then there is regulation services, regulation of local climate, regulation of pathogens, regulation of soil fertility, etc., etc. And then third category, that has to do with culture. For instance, all the amenities provided by nature for tourism activities, protection of such and such animal or plant species, and then you have the major fundamental services. Already in 2015, we had demonstrated that 15 were overused. So we see that everything that affects life, which is undergoing deep and significant changes and very violent changes, which are shifting us in a state which won't be favorable to life and life and climate. The reasons are and the mechanisms are already there, but of course the impact kicks in a few decades later.